You're watching a video series on schema stitching, and this installment is going to talk about stitching directives SDL, or schema definition language. Until now, we've been looking at type merging using static JavaScript configuration. And this time, we're going to start looking at using custom directives to go and configure all of the type merging. The advantage of this approach is that we put all of our schema and all of our type merging configuration into one single flat document, which is managed by the subservice itself. That makes the gateway layer a fairly generic agent at the top, at which time a subservice is able to push one of its schema definitions up to the gateway and have the gateway hot reload or reload without a server restart. All of this code is available in the Schema Stitching Handbook's repo in the Stitching Directives SDL chapter. Switching over to our code here, we're going to start first with our stitch gateway file. The notable new inclusion here is this import from the Stitching Directives package. And stitching directives are being used to build a Stitching Directives transformer, which is installed into our stitch schemas call. And this transformer is the thing that actually reads SDL annotations and translates them into merge configuration. Notably missing from all of our subschemas down here are those merge sections, which describe how types merged. That's all coming from our SDL annotation now. And so our subschemas are just simply combinations of a schema and an executor. And the executor is used down here to go and fetch our subschemas from this SDL endpoint. Remember, we can't get custom directives through schema introspection. So we have to expose some kind of custom query method that's going to go and give our full SDL that includes custom directives. Otherwise, that's really it that's inside of the stitching code. Our subservices themselves have all of their schema and their merge configuration. Here's the user service. We have an inventory service, a product service, and a review service. And it's also worth noting that the merge patterns that we're using here are not necessarily the most optimal patterns. They're very much done for demonstration purposes only in a lot of cases. Now, we do also have to configure our subservices. So going into the accounts schema.js file here, once again, you can see we're importing from the Stitching Directives package, the Stitching Directives helper. That's being used to build type definitions for our directives and a validator for them. Now, we get these by invoking the Stitching Directives helper because we could actually parameterize this if we wanted to. With custom names that we want to go and use for our directives. By default, these things are going to be key, merge, and computed are the names that you get. We would take our type definitions here and first of all, stick them into the top of our type definition string and then concatenate in our GraphQL schema below that. And then expose those down here, putting the raw type definitions into some kind of helper method that our gateway can go and fetch the raw annotated GraphQL schema from. With that done, the only other thing we might want to do is plug our stitching directives validator into schema transforms to provide some feedback if we make mistakes while typing out directives. Taking a look at our gateway running with this code, let's start up our services and then reload our gateway. All right, we've got a big query here. And to kind of break down how this works, we've got products coming from the product service. They have name, price, weight. Inventory service is going to provide in-stock and shipping estimate. Review service is going to provide reviews on products. And then on a review, we'll be able to look back at its product coming from the product service or look at its author coming from the user's service. All of this merge configuration is happening through all of those SDL directives. Starting with our simplest example in the user schema, we've got the annotated SDL over here, and then we've got our static JavaScript configuration that this annotated SDL translates into. So this should look familiar from previous videos, and we're going to just talk about how this annotated SDL translates into this JavaScript configuration. So the most obvious analog here is the selection set. We've gone and we've identified the fact that a user type will always require a base selection set of an ID from another service. And then this merge directive identifies the query that we're going to use for merging this type in this service. So the field name, users, can be inferred simply because the merge directive is applied to the user's query. It can also infer type information by looking at the return type. And then we also can infer which argument we're going to be using, because in this case, there's only one argument. So merge says if there's only one argument, then I know whatever key that I build is going to be stuck into the single argument available. And so in this case, all we really need to do is tell merge what key to build. And so in this case, we're just saying key field is ID, so it's going to read the ID off of original objects, build them into an ID argument known by being the only argument available, and that gives us our static merge configuration. Switching next to the product schema, here we're doing an array batched merge query. And this has a few more arguments in here, which makes it look a little bit bigger, but we're still doing pretty much the same thing. So again, we've got our base selection set. Here we're using UPC as the key. So we're saying whenever we get a product from another service, we'll need its UPC. Again, we're using the merge directive to go and infer the fact that the products field is the field name being merged. And then we're using the key field, UPC, to pick the key that we're going to send in. And then in this case here, merge can't infer what argument is going to receive the key because there are two arguments. So therefore, we have to go and provide this key arg name here. And that basically says that when you go and build a key, send it to the thing called UPCs here. Now, it is possible that we'll also want to provide an order argument, at which time this additional args field can be used to send in a key value mapping written as a string. If we wanted to add additional fields in here, we could do comma, other one. And these additional arguments are going to be static arguments that get included into the arguments object that we build. Switching over to the inventory schema, this one is interesting because it includes a computed field. And it also uses this key scaler, which is a very opaque object that is built by default by the merge directive. And so what we're looking at here is that when a field is declared as a merge without any kind of parameters, the default merge behavior is to literally build an object, key, and this object is going to include the type name of the thing that is being merged, and then it is going to collect all of the fields that were specified in all utilized selection sets. We can see this in action better if we actually go and run a live query. So you can see here that we've got our products. We're going to get name, in stock, shipping estimate. And you can see the key that is actually sent to that service has a type name identifying it as a product and has those three fields that were included in those selection sets. Now, the important thing to note is that this key is only going to include utilized fields from selection sets. So if we were to remove shipping estimate from this query, we're no longer going to utilize the selection set of that computed field. And you'll see that the key shrinks down to just being the base selection set with a type name. Now, as I said before, this key scaler is a little opaque, and so we could improve upon this by making this into a typed input. So I'm going to add a product key input, and this is nice because now I can actually specify input fields. So, and these are actually cast with their proper nullability settings. So we're always going to collect a UPC, and price and weight are both optional. So I could go and pull out our key scaler and swap in our typed input. Then switching over to our runtime here, if we perform this query again, you can see in this case here, I'm getting the same object keys, except that they don't have the type name. The object keys are being stripped down to literally the fields included on that input type. And then the same logistics apply here. If I were to disable the shipping estimate and then run this again, my keys are compacted down to just the base selection set field. Finally, looking quickly at the reviews schema, you'll see that the user's merge is set up using this typed input pattern that we just discussed. Very simple implementation of that. And then this products field is using sort of a needlessly complex example here, where we're actually doing nested input. So our products has an input argument. It takes a product input type, that takes keys, which is a product input key. So this is an example of a nested input. The case where we might encounter this would be as if we're interfacing with a third-party API. Normally, we probably wouldn't want to set up our own stitching architecture using such a complex input pattern. But if we were forced to do something like this, we can accommodate this using the key arg. We can specify a namespace path. So we would build the key and put it at input keys. As always, thank you for watching. All of this code is available in the Schema Stitching Handbook's repo, and I will post a link to this example with this video. Until next time, thank you.